This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, this nasal polyp is of two types. What are the two types? Anthropoinal polyp and ethmoidal polyp. These sinonasal polyps is very important from exam point of view. You may get either a 10 marks question or a 4 marks question, especially in the UG candidates. In PG graduates also, you may guess as a 4 marks question. Okay, this is very, very important topics, and most clinically also you will be seeing more patients in the ENT department presenting with nasal polyposis. Right, so just make sure you know something about this sinonasal polyps. So after the definition, it is of two types: anthropoinal polyp and ethmoidal polyp. So antro means, as I said, antro means, as I said, antrum, maxillary antrum or maxillary sinus. So antrum related to maxillary antrum. Coina means, you know, anterior coina and posterior coina, posterior nerves. Posterior nails also known as coina, which is at the nasopharynx region. So anthropoinal polyp, and second one is ethmoidal polyp. This name itself indicates anthropoinal means it will be arising from the maxillary sinus and extending to the coina, and that means posterior side. So name itself indicates something. And second thing is ethmoidal polyp. Ethmoidal means it will be arising from the ethmoids, right? So now coming to the properties of nasal polyp. These properties of nasal polyps are very important in order to make sure the diagnosis of nasal polyp itself and to differentiate from other conditions which may mimic or present as nasal polyp, right? This is very, these properties should be kept in mind while diagnosing the nasal polyp. So now what will be the properties of these nasal polyps? These may be pale or gray in color. Then they will be glistening. Glistening means shining. When we look in the patient presenting with nasal polyps, either with endoscopy or antirhinoscopy, there will be a shining appearance when we see any patient presenting with nasal polyps, like a reflection from a light. It will be shining or glistening. And the surface of this nasal polyps will be very smooth. There will not be any irregularities or any projections like that. So the surface is very smooth and glistening. And it may be pedunculated. Pedunculated means there will be a stalk-like thing from which it will be arising. Like if it is arising from the maxillary, and another important, very important point is it is insensitive to touch. So what does this insensitive to touch means? See, whenever if you take any sharp object like any ball probe or something like any Jackson's probe, if you touch the polyp with any point, prick point, the patient may not feel any pain, which is almost characteristic of nasal polyp. If you touch any septum or nasal turbinate or anything, the patient may feel pain, but not in nasal polyp. This point should be kept in mind. And these are mobile. And another important point which characterizes nasal polyps is usually it does not bleed on probing or touch. So the points which categorize the nasal polyps are characteristic of nasal polyps is smooth surface and shining or glistening surface. And third thing is insensitive to touch. And fourth one is it does not bleed on probing or touch. These properties should be kept in mind in order to differentiate from other conditions which may mimic nasal polyp. Right? Able to follow here? These properties are important. So now coming to the types, anthropoinal polyp, they said this name itself indicates antrum arising from the maxillary sinus, and coinal, it will be going towards the coina, and it is also known as Killian's polyp. So now coming to the etiology of anthropoinal polyp, usually the etiology of anthropoinal and the second type ethmoidal polyp will be little bit different, but ultimately the management may, medical management may be similar, but etiology is almost different. In etiology of, coming to the etiology of anthropoinal polyp, usually the infection is a main cause for anthropoinal polyp, that is maxillary, that is a polyp which may be arising from the maxillary sinus. So apart from this infection, the allergic rhinitis also plays a role in anthropoinal polyp. So both infection and allergic patients are prone for getting these entropinal poly. So now coming to the theories which postulates or pathogenesis which postulates the development or pathogenesis of entropinal polyps, Breuge theory and Bernoulli's phenomena. These theories, just exam point of view, you should mention that if you get a question of what is the etiopathogenesis of polyps, you should mention these theories. What is this Breuge theory? It is nothing but the anomaly of maxillary sinus hostium. So it is anatomical. These theories states that maxillary polyps are usually arising due to abnormality of maxillary sinus ostium. So if there is any anomaly of the maxillary sinus ostium, as I said, every sinus will be opening into the nasal cavity through respective ostia. So this theory states that if there is any anomaly or anatomical abnormality of maxillary sinus ostium, and this anomaly results in the prolapse of the nasal mucosa through this respective ostia. Usually this anomaly, he says that this maxillary sinus ostium is very wide and it will be extending towards the posterior side. So this bigger size of maxillary sinus ostium and anomaly of abnormal position may lead to prolapse of paranasal sinus mucosa into the nasal cavity and leading to edematous or absorption of tissue fluid, and it may lead to swelling or edematous hypertrophied nasal polyps, mucosa, which leads to polyps. So this theory, according to this theory, you should mention that it is anomaly of maxillary sinus ostium. And second theory states that it is Bernoulli's phenomena. What does this Bernoulli's phenomena state? That as in the previous, in our childhood, we learned that Bernoulli's theory or Bernoulli's phenomena. When we will be seeing a small hut with a cap, if sudden velocity, if any strong wind comes, the hut of the roof of the hut will be elevated or disappeared due to that high pressure. What that does mean is, if there is a high velocity at a particular point, at that point the pressure will be less. So simple example is, if there is any calendar here, if the fan is rotating here, the calendar will move towards the air. That means when there is a velocity in front of the calendar, there will be pressure drop there. So behind the calendar, there will be pressure more. So that means when there is a pressure behind more, it will travel towards the pressure less area. That is, velocity and pressure are opposite. So when there is a Bernoulli's phenomenon, according to this, there will be in the sinus ostium region, there will be a pressure drop due to the constriction of the ostia. There will be a wider maxillary sinus, and there will be constricted maxillary ostium, and again there will be nasal mucosa, and at this sinus ostia region the pressure drop will be less, so that there will be prolapse of nasal mucosa through the ostia into the nasal cavity. According to this theory, it states that, so hope you understood something, this theory. And now coming to the origin, this entropinal polyp, as I said, entro means maxillary sinus, so arises from the maxillary sinus mucosa and exits via its natural and auxiliary ostium and extends to the coina. So the name is entropinal polyp. So why does this entropinal polyp prefer to extend towards the coina? So this is very important point, especially in viva point of view, exam going students. This question will be usually asked in the viva. So just make sure that you know at least two or three points why it prefers to go towards the coina. That's why the name is entropinal polyp. So this maxillary ostium is directed posteriorly, anteroposteriorly. As I said, maxillary ostium should be located. It is located anteroposteriorly. The diameter is anteroposterior, and there will be cilia, because the lining epithelium is pseudosatified ciliated epithelium. So obviously cilia will move from anterior to posterior. Any nasal secretions, will be subconsciously swallowing our secretions, nasal secretions. Why? Because this cilia will beat towards the posterior side, right? So the nasal secretions which are secreted in the nasal cavity will be go ultimately into the posterior nasal cavity or coina, and will be swallowing that either into the digestive cavity or like that. So these cilia will be posteriorly directed. So there, obviously, this is one of the theory. And air current posteriorly in a greater force. So as we are breathing here, the air current will flow from anterior to posterior. And the slope of the nasal floor also directs to the posteriorly. So there will be flow, as our nasal cavity is in this line, that it will be, the air will be entering like this and it will go downwards, right? There will be slope from anterior part to posterior part. And compared to the anterior nasal region, the posterior nasal cavity is wider. And there will be negative oropharyngeal pressure while swelling. As we deglute or swell, there will be negative pressure created in the oropharynx. So we are able to swallow or drink water, everything like that. So these are the possible mechanisms why AC polyps or entrocoenal polyps prefer to extend towards the coena. Hope at least make sure you remember at least 2-3 points here. It will be very useful in Viva point of view. The maxillary ostium is directed posteriorly. Cilia movement will be posterior and posterior nasal cavity is larger. These 3 points make sure you remember. So now coming to the parts of ileum's and entrocoenal polyps, usually it will be having 3 parts, antral, coenal and nasal part. So antral part means it will be located in the maxillary antrum. Coenal part means it will be located in the coena or posterior nares or nasal cavity. Nasal means it will be located in the nasal cavity. So 3 parts, one in the sinus, that is antral, this one. And coenal means towards the nasal cavity, and nasal means within the nasal cavity. So these parts, if needed, you may just draw a diagram like this. Trilobed structure, the 3 lobes, antral, coenal and nasal. You may draw just trilobed structure and name it as CNA, usually entrocoenal polyps from antrum to nose and nose to coenal, antro, nasal, coenal. So now coming to the clinical presentation of entrocoenal polyp, in which people these are common? As I said, it will be usually due to infection or allergic. So usually it is usually seen in children and adults and age. That children means it will be most commonly seen in 14, 15 years or less than 25 years, like these patients. Usually these patients will be presenting with unilateral nasal obstruction and unilateral nasal discharge occasionally as nasal mass. So the main difference, one of the main difference coming to entrocoenal and ethmoidal is usually ethmoidal polyps are bilateral condition. It will be present in both nasal cavities, whereas entrocoenal polyp is in unilateral condition. So usually these patients are presenting with unilateral nasal obstruction or unilateral nasal discharge, right? So sometimes if the patient may not present with unilateral nasal obstruction in entrocoenal polyp, he may present also with bilateral nasal condition. In which condition the patient may present with bilateral nasal obstruction means, as I said, this the name indicates entrocoenal. Once this part goes from nose to coena, coena is a single cavity compared to those 2 nostrils. So once the mass goes to the coena, there will be obstruction for the whole air entry into the larynx or trachea. So there will be bilateral nasal obstruction once. So bilateral nasal obstruction also may be common in entrocoenal polyp once the polyp goes to a coena region. So see here the image, you see, by just lifting the patient's nose, you may able to see the polyp here or nasal mass here. And in the oral cavity, you will be seeing a globular mass here. It will be hanging into the oropharynx. It is nothing but the coenal part. When this mass extends in whole, occupies the whole oropharynx, usually the patient may present with bilateral nasal obstruction. So usually one thing we should make sure in entrocoenal polyp is, usually in anterior rhinoscopy, you may not see any signs, or usually in antirhinoscopy, the patient may not press, you may not see any mass like thing. You may observe in posterior rhinoscopy, because as the entrocoenal polyp goes posteriorly, you may not observe anything on anterior rhinoscopy. So usually in antirhinoscopy, you may visible up to anterior 1/3 region of the middle turbinate. So you may not obviously see what is behind the middle turbinate. So the main examination point of view, the patient and the examiner may have to look to posterior rhinoscopy. What does this posterior rhinoscopy mean? You may observe here there is a curved mirror. There is a mirror here, and the shaft of the mirror handle is little bit bent. With this, the patient, you will be ask for the patient to open the mouth and you put this mirror into the oral cavity. Through that you will be seeing behind the uvula, and you may observe the mass. So large polyp may hang down behind the soft palate and present in the oral palate. See, this is a soft palate and this is a polyp. So you may observe like this also if the patient is large polyp is not hanging down or itself in the posterior coina. So more than anti-rhinoscopy, posterior rhinoscopy is a more useful guide in antroquinal polyp. Another point here in the instrument point of view is you will be definitely asked in the viva differentiate between posterior rhinoscopy mirror and laryngeal mirror, indirect laryngeal mirror, IDL. So one point you should make sure is in posterior rhinoscopy mirror there will be a bend here in the shaft of the rhinoscopy mirror, but in IDL mirror you will not see any bend there. It will be straight. This is very important, and by this you should observe, identify which mirror is right. You will be placing two mirrors on the table and you will ask you to observe or identify which is PRS mirror, posterior rhinoscopy mirror, and which is IDL mirror. The those with bend is PRS mirror and without bend and straight is IDL mirror. This is viva point of view. And now coming to the any patient presenting with a nasal mass, any nasal mass, you should differentiate whether it is a mass or something like a polyp or something like that. So how will you inspect those patients? You should observe whether it is uvula size, means unilateral or bilateral size, it is smaller or bigger, number, single or multiple. Usually this antroquinal polyp is single, but in ethmoidal polyp is multiple. It is grape-like structure. We'll be discussing in the next few slides. And color. Color is used, as I said, with a smooth surface and glistening. It may be pedunculated or sessile, origin and attachment. Usually this maxillary sinus, antroquinal polyp is origin from the maxillary sinus. So it will be originating from the lateral region. The maxillary sinus will be lateral to the nose, no? So it will be the origin should be from the lateral side. And another point is probing. As I said, this nasal polyp is insensitive to touch. So you should observe by just poking the polyp whether the patient is feeling any pain or not. So usually insensitive to touch, and there will be no bleeding on touch also. And another thing is the probe able to pass all around. Usually the probe has to pass all around, but if the probe is not passed all around, you may suspect another causes like hypertrophied middle turbinate or something like that. But if the probe is passed all around the nasal mass and insensitive to touch and no bleeding on touch and small soft inconsistency, these all points towards the nasal polyp. And another important point of nasal these polyps is it will be shrinkage with inconsistent drops. So we should observe whether the masses are shrinkage with decongestant drops like xylometazoline or not. So now coming to the probe test, as I said, antroquinal polyp. So the major differential diagnosis of antroquinal polyp is hypertrophied infield turbinate or hypertrophied middle turbinate. Okay, as I said, we will be having three turbinates, inferior, middle and superior turbinate. This hypertrophied middle or inferior turbinate will be the most common differential diagnosis for AC polyp. So how will you differentiate those? In AC polyp, as I said, it is insensitive to pain, but hypertrophied turbinate is sensitive to pain. In AC polyp, the probe can be passed all around the mass or polyp. But in hypertrophied, it will be arising from the lateral side or superior side. Your probe can't be passed all around. And AC polyp is a mobile structure, and hypertrophic inferior turbinate is not mobile structure. It is attached to the bone. So differential diagnosis, as I said, any mass, any patient presenting with a nasal mass, you should identify whether it is a DLA mass or a polyp or something like that. So what will be the differential diagnosis? Hypertrophied inferior turbinate. As I said in the previous slide, how will you differentiate? You should make sure this should be done. In order to differentiate this, hypertrophied inferior turbinate usually not that much glistening, and there will be sensitive to pain, everything like that. And another differential diagnosis is blob of mucosa or mucosal secretions. What does this blob of mucosal secretions means? Any these, as I said, there will be glistening appearance of the nasal polyps. So this mucosa also due to its water content, there will be a reflection of light, and the patient may also appear as glistening. And obviously, the secretions, the patients may not feel any pain if you touch there. So if you ask the patient to blow the nose, if the secretions or blob of mucosa disappears, it is just nothing but a pulled up secreted nasal mucosal secretions and not nasal polyps. In this way, you will differentiate from the nasal polyps, which will be disappearing on the blowing of the nose. Another differential diagnosis, inverted papilloma and angiofibroma. These may also, the another important feature of inverted papilloma is it may also present as nasal polyps. So it may not present just like a mass, but it may also present as polyp. But features which distinguish from this the nasal polyps is usually it is friable, it will be bleeding on touch, and the surface which will be irregular. Okay, these points towards the inverted papilloma. And another point, differential diagnosis is angiofibroma. So how will you differentiate angiofibroma from polyp? It is usually pinkish in color, pink to reddish in color angiofibroma. The consistency is not smooth and it will be firm in consistency, and there will be a tendency to bleed on touch. So usually these features will differentiate from the nasal polyps. So that's why in the beginning of the slide, I said properties of nasal polyps. Everything. So and the malignancy also presents with the same like that also. It may bleed on touch and the consistency will be firm to hard, and usually in the older age group, everything like that. So now coming to the investigations for a patient presenting with AC polyp. So diagnostic nasal endoscopy, what is DNE means? You will be seeing the patient through the nose, nasal cavity, and you will be directly inspecting whether it's a polyp or mass, everything like that. Direct inspection, diagnostic nasal endoscopy. And another is X-ray PNS, Waters view. Waters view is this one. You will be seeing whether there is any haziness in the maxillary sinus or not. If the same view to open mouth, it is, it will be also seeing the sphenoid sinus. And another X-ray issue may order is X-ray of nasopharynx lateral view. From the lateral side, there will be presence of air between the skull base and polyp. As I said, this AC polyp will be growing behind. So once it goes behind, you should be, you may get a doubt whether this polyp is arriving from behind to anterior or anterior to posterior. So this X-ray nasopharynx lateral view will make you make clear there will be a presence of air, there will be presence of gap between this polyp and the nasopharynx or skull base. Behind region, there will be the polyp will be from coming from the nasal cavity towards the posterior coina. This is a skull base or posterior pharyngeal wall, nasopharyngeal wall. There will be a gap in between this polyp and this pharyngeal wall. So there will be, you will be seeing the air in between. So this lateral view will make sure that there will be a gap, so that this gap or presence of air indicates the mass is arising from anterior to posterior, but not from posterior to anterior, right? So another investigation, the main investigation which will be very useful for doing surgeries is CTPNS, especially coronal cuts. Later you may reconstruct to axial or sagittal plane depending upon the need, but coronal cuts are the main useful for CTPNS. So this is a DNS, a diagnostic nasal endoscopy, DNE. The examiner or doctor will be seeing the patient by passing the endoscope through the nose. You will be seeing here. So the septum, inferior terminal, the nasal mass, everything like that. As I said, the next investigation is X-ray paranasal sinuses. See, here you may see some haziness in the oral cavity. This is nothing but the AC polyp, which is hanging from anterior to posterior into the oral cavity, this way. And this arrow also indicates this haziness. This is a convex border which is present in the maxillary sinus. This is nothing but the right maxillary polyp. This curved structure haziness present. Air, presence of air indicates blackish color. This black is nothing but air. This curved structure is AC polyp which is hanging towards the posterior side. You can see the haziness in the oral cavity. So this is a CTPNS, you will be seeing this is the maxillary sinus ostium. If there is nothing in the maxillary sinus, only air, it will be black in color. So if there is any haziness here, you will be seeing here. This is the maxillary polyp arising from the sinus ostium into the nasal cavity here. Okay, there will be widening of the ostium also here. See how big a wide it became. compared to this normal side. This is the NP turbinate on both sides, this is the middle turbinate, and this is the ethmoid, this is the orbit, everything. Now coming to the treatment part of enterocoenal polyp. So they say it may be due to infection, so pre and post operatively the patient should be kept on antibiotics, usually amoxiclav, if there is any associated infections or if the polyps are associated with rhinosinusitis. And next treatment is avulsion polypectomy with middle meatal antrostomy. These are old days surgeries. Now the surgical treatment of choice is PES. PES means functional endoscopic sinus surgery. This is a treatment part. So here the nasal mucosa will be preserved and all the polyps are removed from the nasal cavity and the sinus ostium will be widened so that there will be ventilation to the respective sinuses. Functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Why it is called functional? Because you should not disturb the nasal mucosa. The normal architecture or physiological architecture of the nasal mucosa or paranasal sinus mucosa is not disturbed. So endoscopic sinus surgery. So another one is Caldwell loop operation for recurrence. If there is any, by means, any chance of recurrence or a patient got recurrence, so the next possibility the patient is getting repeated recurrence tendency and recurrence, next choice is Caldwell loop operation. So this is the maxillary middle meatal antrostomy opening done in the maxillary sinus ostium. And this is the Caldwell loop operation. You will be giving an incision in the buccal mucosa, this region, this gingival lesion, by lifting the upper lip and making an opening here. As I said in the previous class, this floor of the maxillary sinus and this alveolus are closely related because the floor is nothing but the upper maxilla. So you may enter into the maxillary sinus through that opening also. For any recurrence cases or inaccessible cases through FES, if the axillary polyp is inaccessible for endoscopic treatment, and for also recurrence cases, you may directly go into this maxillary sinus through this opening, especially for antral polyps, anterior wall polyps, which may be somewhat difficult for routine endoscopic surgery. So how to prevent recurrence? It is nothing but complete removal of all parts, as I said, three parts, antrum, nasal and coil parts, and wide middle meatal antrostomy. And another point is you should be made clear the ostium is widened adequately so that there will be ventilation into the respective sinuses. And if there is any, by means, any chance of accessory ostium along with the natural ostium, we should combine both the natural ostium and accessory ostium. We should not leave the accessory ostium like that. This point is very, very important in order to prevent a recirculation phenomenon, because the air current or sinal mucosal secretions will be circulating there only if you won't connect the both the openings. So wide meatal antrostomy should be done and postoperative antibiotics. Hope you make somewhat clear about this enterocoenal polyp. Now coming to the next, ethmoidal polyps. So usually in ethmoidal polyps, as I said, in AC polyps, usually it will be presenting in the children. In ethmoidal polyps, it will be in the adult patients mostly. In AC polyp, usually it is present in the adolescent or younger age group. In ethmoidal polyps, it will be mostly seen in adult population, and there will be bilateral, it is, as I said, this is also bilateral condition. So you can see bilateral nasal polyps prolapsing in the nasal cavity here, both. So the patient obviously presents with bilateral nasal obstruction. If there is a disturbance in the movement of nasal secretion, the patient may also present with bilateral nasal discharge. As the air entry into the nasal cavity decreases, the patient obviously tells he may have decreased sense of smell also. So the patient here, another important point is in the ethmoidal polyps is most commonly the etiology is allergy rather than infection, which is the case in AC polyp. So as the patient, as we know, the allergy patients will be prone for getting sneezing, itching, everything. So apart from bilateral nasal obstruction and nasal discharge, in ethmoidal polyp patients will be getting sneezing and rhinorrhea. And there is a chance of getting recurrence in ethmoidal polyps compared to AC polyps, because the main pathology here is allergy. So the patient, even after treatment, you should make sure the patient is on anti-allergic treatment. So the recurrence rate in ethmoidal polyps is more compared to AC polyp. So these the differences you should keep in mind. Hope these differences are clear for all. See, as you said, ethmoidal polyps you can see in anterior rhinoscopy easily compared to AC polyps, because AC polyp will be growing posterior. You may miss in anterior rhinoscopy, but usually these ethmoidal polyps will be multiple in number, not single like AC polyp. So it will be grape-like structure when we see in anterior rhinoscopy, and will be directed anteriorly. So they will be projecting from anteriorly. So you can see on the anterior rhinoscopy easily. See, there will be broadening of the nasal bridge where the arrow is pointing here. In ethmoidal polyps, due to its bilateral condition, there will be broadening of nasal bridge here, and there will be increased distance also between the eye, intercanthal distance. Hypertelorism may also be present in severe cases of ethmoidal polyps, not in all cases, in some cases. So coming to the etiology, usually the allergy is a main etiological factor for ethmoidal polyp. Apart from this, another etiopathogenesis is allergy plus infection, vasomotor imbalance, Bernoulli's phenomenon, as I said before, polysaccharide changes. So etiology part, infection is most commonly caused for AC polyp, and allergy is most common for ethmoidal polyp. Sorry. So now coming to associated diseases of ethmoidal polyps are aspirin intolerance. As I said in the previous class, Sanchez triad is a 2 marks question. So what comes under Sanchez triad is aspirin insensitivity, bronchial asthma, and ethmoidal polyps. It is a non-allergic entity. So you should make sure Sanchez triad is a non-allergic entity. It mainly is due to aspirin insensitivity. So these may patients also get the polyps. It is a non-allergic. As I said, ethmoidal polyps are said this is due to allergic entity. So, but this Sanchez triad, the presence of ethmoidal polyps, bronchial asthma, and aspirin, it will not, in these patients, there will be usually, say, it is a non-allergic entity. You may also get an MCQ here, so which is not a part of Sanchez triad. You may get options like this, aspirin insensitivity, bronchial asthma, ethmoidal polyps, and allergic reaction, allergic. So the option should be here is allergic. It will be tempting to put allergic as non-option. So another associated disease is cystic fibrosis, cartilaginous syndrome, Eng syndrome. So cartilaginous syndrome, apart from ethmoidal polyps, the patient will be also having ciliary dyskinesia and situs inversus. So in Eng syndrome, the patient will be having ciliary dysmotility, so that hyperviscosity mucus and angiospermia. In both cartilaginous syndrome and Eng syndrome, there will be ciliary dyskinesia and ethmoidal polyps. In cartilaginous syndrome, extremely it will be sinus inversus. In Eng syndrome, it will be angiospermia. Angiospermia means absence of sperms in the male, which may lead to infertility. So now coming to investigations which won't alter compared to AC polyps, the same investigations we should do: diagnostic nasal endoscopy, X-ray PNS, CT PNS. Test for allergy. As this is an allergic entity, you should concentrate on allergic testing. And if the patient is allergic to particular allergens, either pollen or dust or any something like that, so we will make sure advise the patient not to take these allergens or avoid those allergens. So allergic test may play a role in ethmoidal polyps and also to prevent recurrence. So this is the diagnostic DNA exam point of view. This is the septum, and you can see on both sides this nasal polyps. So this is the CT paranasal sinuses. See here, you have the both the maxillary sinuses are clear here. So but you will be seeing an haziness in both the nasal cavity. So this indicates bilateral ethmoidal polyps. If there is haziness both in the nasal cavity and the maxillary sinus on the unilateral side, you may suspect anteroclonal polyp. So if there is haziness in both the maxillary nasal cavity regions between the septum, you may suspect bilateral ethmoidal polyposis. Sometimes the patient may present with both the conditions, which may be a case in pan-sinusitis or pan-polyposis. So now coming to the last few slides, non-surgical treatment of nasal polyposis. So the first thing is avoid allergens as the allergic entity, and another thing is oral antihistamines. So these antihistamines like levocetirizine, fexofenadine, and desloratadine, those are antihistamines, especially second generation antihistamines, are used or mostly useful if the patient is co-allergic patient presenting with ethmoidal polyps. these antihistamines are not that much useful if the patient is not allergic. And another important non-surgical treatment point of view is corticosteroid nasal spray. This should be used almost for up to 2 to 4 months. And if it is, there should be a break in between the using this nasal spray. If the patient is using for more than 2 months, at least you should take break for 1 week to 10 days. After that, he may continue again. So another treatment non-surgical is oral prednisolone or systemic steroid. So usually it will be good in the dose of 1 mg/kg per day for maximum 2 to 3 weeks, not more than 3 weeks. Oral corticosteroids not more than 2 months at a time. Oral prednisolone not more than 2 to 3 weeks at a time. This point should be very, very clear in your mind in treatment point of view. So see this picture, you'll be able to clear. This is the pre-steroid versus post-steroid application. So this is the pre-steroid picture on the left, having a huge mass of polyps, and the post, it will be a little bit decreased by after the steroid treatment. So there, by this you may get a conclusion. These steroids are like a medical polypectomy. If the polyps are very small, and this steroid treatment almost, it's like a surgery treatment. So it is also known as medical polypectomy. As I said in the previous class, you may also get a question like medical polypectomy. There will be a shrinkage in the size of the nasal polyps. If there is a small polyps, these polyps may also disappear by the steroid treatment, and patient will be symptomatically improved. So now coming to the next surgical treatment, then these are all the previously abandoned surgeries not doing now, intranasal eversion polypectomy. Now the surgery of choice is functional endoscopic surgery, which may be either due to conventional microdebrider or laser. So any coming to the surgical point, you should mention FESS, nothing but FESS, F-E-S-S, FESS, functional endoscopic sinus surgery. So the final, it may are doing like just conventional method or microdebrider or laser. Conventional means using the instruments like this. The patient will be passing instruments, endoscopy and instruments. These are the instruments which will be using in the conventional method. These are the Alice forceps, this is a backbiting forceps, this is a trocar, this is upturn, this is straight, this is caris and sponge, everything like this. These are the FESS instruments. So this is the microdebrider. This is another instrument which is more popularly used for nasal polyposis. There will be blades rotating here. So this will suck the nasal polyposis, and there will be discharge. And simultaneously, there will be water irrigation also. So this is a test with navigation. What means, because this nose is prone for getting skull base injuries, see, you can see a computer monitor here. The surgeon is doing the surgery with the navigation. Navigation means you will be having the four screen, computer screen, which will be divided into four blocks here. Four blocks. One block will be axial cut, one block will be coronal cut, and one block will be axial cut. Another means the schematic view or the plane in which the patient is slept. So these four planes, at a time when the patient, the surgeon kept his navigator here, instrument with the navigator in the nose, you will be pointing, you will be seeing in the monitor where the exact location of the navigation or the surgeon is there. In both, in all the three views. Okay. So how to prevent recurrence, complete removal of polyps in avoid allergens and post-operative course of oral antihistamines and corticosteroid nasal spray. So in order to prevent recurrence of ethmoidal polyps, you should be removed polyps completely and avoid allergens because it is allergic entity. And patient should also have a oral antihistamines and corticosteroid nasal spray for a few months. So in few patients, if the patient is more severely allergic, he may also require a lifelong treatment for corticosteroid nasal spray. So this is a bilateral FESS cavities after surgery. And this is a post-surgical, post-FESS coronal CT. See, there will be a widening of ostium and then the sinus were clear. So these are also important last slide, AC polyp and ethmoidal polyps differences. So just recap, AC polyps are just seen in adolescence and children region, ethmoidal polyps in adult. Etiology is infection in AC polyp, allergic in ethmoid. It is single entity, it will be going towards the coina. In bilateral, ethmoidal polyps are bilateral and multiple. So it is a trilobite structure. As I said, it will be having antral, nasal, and coronal parts. So it is trilobite structure, like just our flag, Indian flag. It is trilobite. Ethmoidal polyps are bunch of grape-like structure. It is multiple, so it will be grape-like. Draksha gutti laga untai. So AC polyp is nothing but AC polyp will grow backwards. That's why the name coenal. Ethmoidal polyps will be growing forward. So EF, just remember EF. If you forgot, so BC, backward coenal, ethmoidal forward. So treatment of AC polyp is mostly surgical because here the etiological factor is almost the infection or CRS. Here ethmoidal polyp, both medical and surgical treatment because allergic is the cause. Recurrence is uncommon in AC polyps, but it will be common in ethmoidal polyps because of the allergic etiology. Hello. This nasal polyposis is complete. Hope something went into your minds, your brains. Hello.
Yes, sir.
This the class is complete.
Okay, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.